Welcome to worship at First United Methodist Church Richardson. I'm Clayton Oliphant, pastor of the church, and we're so glad that you've joined us this day. We want to thank our Caroline Ringers for the beautiful prelude this morning. It is so good to hear them and to be blessed by their music. We hope that you'll register your attendance this morning. And again, we're so glad that you've joined us this day from wherever you're watching us, wherever you are taking in this worship service. We hope that you'll be blessed by it. We want to share some great news with you today that you as a congregation have stepped up to the plate in a marvelous way during this season, and you've provided resources that have made possible almost 900 tote bags that have now been distributed to homeless shelters. Four of our partner ministries that are caring for men and women who are homeless now have received tote bags to remind people that they are loved during this season. And I want to thank you for your generosity. I want to also encourage you to join us for our Christmas Eve worship services on the 24th. It's going to be a great evening of worship. We have services that will be live streamed and on Facebook Live and YouTube at 4 and at 6. And then we'll be broadcasting our worship services at 9 and 11 on local television station KTXA. We'd love for you to tell your friends about that and invite them to join us through broadcast medium for our Christmas Eve services. Again, we're so glad that you're here joining us for worship this day. This is the day the Lord has made. Let us rejoice and be glad in it.
Hello, we're the Castons. I'm Kim, Bob, Brooks, Laura, and Bennett, and it is wonderful to be with you today.
On this fourth Sunday of Advent, we sing songs of hope, peace, and joy. We pray, we listen, and we give thanks to our Almighty God for our many blessings.
As we light the candle of love, we recognize that we are united by the unconditional love of Christ. We celebrate that God is love, and in the birth of Jesus the Christ, love took on flesh to dwell among us, our Emmanuel.
In our homes we wait, come, O come, Emmanuel. Let this light be the guide as we wait for the Christ child to remind us how to live in the light of love.
come to the time of prayer in our service, I invite you to go to our website at fumcr.com/prayer to see the current prayer list or to add your own prayer concerns to that list. And now will you join with me as we go to God in prayer? Let us pray. Oh God, we come today just a week before Christmas, anticipating the arrival of your Son. But there is so much left to do that even in this pandemic time, when our worlds are much smaller, some of us are feeling overwhelmed with getting ready. Some of us still don't have definite plans and wait for the right circumstances to be together. Others are resigned to being by themselves. But regardless of our situations, we wait. Wait in anticipation of your arrival all over again to live among us, to guide us, to comfort us, to speak to us of how we should live. For in these days of turmoil, confusion, and discord, we need you more than ever. We need your calmness, your faithfulness, the strength present in your words and actions. For at times we are strong, and other times we are weak. There are times when we are faithful, and times when we stray, giving in to temptation. This Advent time, we remember Mary and Joseph, giving thanks for their faithfulness, their courage and obedience, stepping out into the unknown in the strength of your Spirit, playing their part in the fulfillment of your plan to bring your prodigal people home again. We pray that their example might be the pattern of our lives, that when your gentle whisper breaks through the clamor of this world and into our small corner, we might be ready to listen, and having listened, to act. God, we ask for your comfort to cover those who have lost loved ones, friends, jobs, and financial security during these past months. May this Christmas season be a time of slowing down, of carols sung with family, games played together, watching favorite Christmas movies, reading good books curled up on the couch, baking family recipes, and loving on one another, whether we are apart or together. And most of all, feeling your loving arms around each of us, holding us close, letting us know that we are yours and are loved. Now let us pray the prayer that Jesus taught his disciples to pray, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Your contributions and pledges go to keep the ministries and mission of First United Methodist Church Richardson going during these months. You may text your contribution, give online, or send your check to the church. Our Christmas Advent offering will go to UMCOR, the United Methodist Committee on Relief, to help with recovery from natural disasters, and to network of community ministries to help families in our community. Be sure that you write Advent offering on your check for that particular donation. And now let us continue as we worship, hearing the chancel choir sing The Little Drummer Boy.
Gifts we bring, pa-rum-pa-pum-pum. Cheryl Bishop, Director of Family Ministry. And in Children's Time today, we're talking about angels again. We've talked about angels appearing to Mary and Joseph, and today we're going to hear the story about when the angels appeared to the shepherds. First, there was one angel in the sky, and guess what the angel said first? Do not be afraid. The angel was there to tell the shepherds that on that night, Jesus had been born, that the Messiah had been born, that Jesus was born, and that they could find him in a manger wrapped in bands of cloth, and that Jesus was born for all people. Now, I can imagine the shepherds who were out in their fields in the darkness were very surprised by this angel bringing them the news. But then suddenly, there were hundreds of angels. It was a multitude of angels all around them to light up all of the fields. And I also wonder if maybe all of the light from the angels was also to help show them the way to Bethlehem so that they could find the Christ child. As we light candles, and we turn on our Christmas trees with all of the lights on them this year, I pray that you will know that the light of Christ, that the birth of Jesus is for you. And just as the angels shared that with the shepherds, and then the shepherds traveled to Bethlehem and told Mary all that they'd heard, we also get to travel through the darkness to tell others about the light of Christ. That the light is shared with us, and then we get to share the light with others. To remember that on Christmas Day, Jesus was born for you. And as you share that news with others, I pray that you'll remember these words of the angels. Glory to God in the highest. Will you say it with me? Glory to God in the highest. Spread that good news this Christmas as you share the light and love of Christ with everyone else around you. Let's say a prayer before we go. Are you ready? Let's pray. Awesome God, thank you for angels who spread the good news. Help us share your light with others around us. Help us remember that Christmas Day is the day Jesus is born. Glory to God in the highest. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Merry Christmas.
Today's scripture text comes from the second chapter of the Gospel of St. Luke. It's the story of the shepherds and the angels in the birth narrative. Hear these words of our Lord. In that region, there were shepherds living in the fields, keeping watch over their flock by night. Then an angel of the Lord stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for see, I am bringing you good news of great joy for all the people. To you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, who is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a child wrapped in bands of cloth and lying in a manger." And suddenly there was with the angel a multitude of the heavenly hosts praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace among those whom he favors." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go now to Bethlehem and see this thing that has taken place, which the Lord has made known to us." So they went with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the child lying in a manger. When they saw this, they made known what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds told them. But Mary treasured all these words and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all they had heard and seen, as it had been told them. This is the word of our Lord.
Goodness and light, he will bring us.
Thank you to our ensemble for the beautiful music this morning. Speaking of music, I'm a country and western music fan. I know that would come as a surprise to some of you, but you have to understand that one of the first churches that I served, when I asked the organist my first Sunday, I was sitting down with the organist, and I said, what kind of music does the church like? What are the favorite hymns of this church? She said, oh, we like both kinds, hon. And I said, both kinds? She said, oh yeah, we like country and western music. So you can understand that, you know, it kind of got in my blood serving that church, that they like country western. And I've been a fan of country western music since my teen years. And in fact, I've collected some of my favorite country music lyrics. I think country music writers are some of the greatest poets of our society, and their ability to turn a phrase is something that I've always marveled at, how they can take an idea. A lot of it's about heartbreak and heartache and mama and trucks and prison and all kinds of things like that. But, you know, there's something about turning a phrase that these country and western songwriters just have a gift that I wish I had. So I'm going to share with you some of my favorite country western song titles and lyrics. For instance, Dan Hicks sang this in the 1960s, "How can I miss you if you won't go away?" Or then there's Wynn Stewart's, "I keep forgetting that I forgot about you." Or "I'm so miserable without you, it's just like having you around." Or "Thank God and Greyhound You're Gone" by Roy Clark. And then I love this one, "You done tore out my heart and stomped that sucker flat." Bill Anderson wrote this in the 1960s, "When you leave, walk out backwards, so I'll think you're walking in." And then more recent songs, some of the songs I love are like, "I've got tears in my ears from lying on my back and crying my eyes out over you." Or "Blame it on your lying, cheating, cold, dead, beating, two-timing, double-dealing, mean, mistreating, loving heart." That's from Patti Loveless. Or one of my favorites is George Strait, "Let's fall to pieces together." I mean, that's such a great phrase, "Let's fall to pieces together." "Drop kick me, Jesus, through the goalpost of life," always one of my favorites. Or "I bought the boots that just walked out on me." Again, you know, just the ability to turn a phrase. My wife ran off with my best friend, and I sure do miss him. I mean, the ability to turn a phrase like that is just a gift that country songwriters have. But one of my favorites all time in terms of turning a phrase, because you've heard the phrase, well, you know, "I've got friends in high places," was Garth Brooks' twist on that when he sang the song, "I've Got Friends in Low Places." And he starts out that song with that classic line, "Blame it all on my roots, I showed up in boots and ruined your black tie affair." And, you know, just the ability to take that phrase that we say in society sometimes, "I've got friends in high places," and twist it and say, "I've got friends in low places." Well, Luke tells us about the shepherds, and the story of the shepherds is the story about how God had friends in low places. There's something about the story of the shepherds that connects us to a God who cares about the least and the overlooked and the lost. A God who is with us and for us and working in our lives to demonstrate to us that we are loved by God. And in the Christmas story, you have the three kings that, you know, that the royalty that come to see baby Jesus, but you also have the lowly shepherds. And I want to today talk about their experience and their story, because I think it's instructive for our own lives. And the first thing that I'd lift up is that God reaching out through the angels to the shepherds is a sign for all people, even the lowly. A sign for all people. That message of the angels just reaches out across the generations. I bring you good news of great joy, which will come to all people. For to you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, Messiah, who is Christ the Lord. And this will be a sign for you. You will find a babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And that message of the angels to the shepherds. Who were the shepherds? The shepherds were really the outcast of society. The shepherds were those people who were essential in the economic picture of the society, but were overlooked by society. They played an essential role in terms of the economy, but people really didn't want shepherds around them. They really didn't invite the shepherds over for Sunday dinner. They didn't have the shepherds come to their temple because the shepherds were smelly and didn't keep the cleanliness laws that were demanded in order to worship. The shepherds were good people, but seen as outcasts, sometimes not even considered good. Some of the ancient writings talk about the shepherds as seen as kind of just not very good people, people that were less than honest. And to see that Luke tells us and intentionally tells us this connection that God has reached to the shepherds, that God has friends in low places like the shepherds, and that the message of God's love to the world, known in and through Jesus Christ, is a message for all people. Have we all understood that? I think sometimes we forget it. I know I do. Sometimes we forget this good news is for all the world, for everyone. And it tells us that God is concerned about the inherent worth and dignity of every single human being on this planet. Everyone is a child of God. And to be treated as less than a child of God is inconsistent with what the Bible teaches us. The message of the angels to the shepherds is indeed good news for all the world, that there is a God who loves us, even those of us who feel like we're lowly, less than, outcast, those of us who have been picked on or set aside by society, those of us who've been oppressed, those who have been discarded, find in Jesus a friend, someone who loves them and is in his being a sign and symbol of God's love, God's inherent value placed in the lives of every person. This is indeed good news, that God's got friends in low places. Even people like you and me are loved and valued by God. And if you don't know that this Christmas, I just want to invite you into that truth. I want to invite you to claim your worth and the dignity that comes from being the child of God that you are. You are loved. You are a blessing to this world. The story of the shepherds tells us this, that every person, this good news of God's love is for all of us, for all people. And I pray that you would claim that, and I pray that you would help others claim that this Christmas. The second thing that we find in this story is that the shepherds go and see for themselves. You read this in verse 15, when the angels went away from them into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let us go. Let us go over to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us." And they went with haste. they went with haste. Everyone must take their own journey. Everyone must take their own journey to the manger in Bethlehem. And I think that the shepherd's example is that they've received this good news, but then they go and investigate and see for themselves what God has done. Let us go to Bethlehem. And they went with haste. I think there's a message for us that each one of us has a journey to take. And that journey may look different for every one of us, but that journey is a journey to find the truth about who Jesus is to each of us and what it means for us to claim a relationship with Jesus, what it means for us to have a Savior in our lives, a source of strength and help in times of struggle and times of need, to know that God cares about us and walks with us and has come to be with us in Christ. That's a journey of exploration. And I want to invite you to take that journey if you haven't already, and to do so with haste, to go and see this thing that God has done in the birth of this child. I know far too many people who've given up on faith and religion. They've given up on the church. They hear a story about a television evangelist who buys a jet, and they dismiss all religion as false. They have a bad experience in their lives, and they believe that somehow God has punished them, and they walk away from God, believing that if there is a God, that God must not care about them because of the bad experience that they had. Or they get lost in arguments about science and religion, believing that there's somehow you can't believe one without believing the other, without rejecting the other. And I think people sometimes give up too soon on who God is and the importance of God in their lives. People turn away from the church because they find the church is not perfect. Well, no, the church is not perfect. It's a human institution striving to do divine work on God's behalf, but it's a human institution, so it's far from perfect. But that doesn't mean God isn't real. And I find that far too many people have started to take that journey or have just given up on it altogether or quit too soon because somehow something took them off that pathway. I know in talking to church members that you're concerned, some of you, about your children and grandchildren and the journeys that they have taken and how that journey has led them away from the church. I think Christmas is a time for us to maybe rethink the question and, like the shepherds, go and see for ourselves this thing that God has done. Because I think there's some things in life that can't be explained. I mean, you can't explain how God shows up in unexpected places and through unexpected people, how God reaches us with this message of love, how God surprises us with a sunset that takes our breath away, how God reaches to us and our moments of despair and darkness with this good news that we are loved. I don't know how people live their lives without faith, but I've watched far too many people try to do it. And I know that this journey is one of urgency. The shepherds went with haste to see what God had done. I want to invite anyone who's maybe stopped that journey or reverse course and gone away from the church or their faith, maybe this is a time for you to reinvestigate what the faith is all about and this God who has come to us in Christ to not fix all of our problems, but to be our strength in the midst of our problems, to be our source of hope in the midst of despair. Yes, even in the midst of a pandemic. I'll close with this, that the shepherds, this story of the shepherds ends as they return back to the sheep, glorifying and praising God. So after this amazing experience of experiencing God's grace and God's love, wrapped up in swaddling cloths and lying in a manger, the shepherds return to the smelly sheep. They go back to work. They go back to their lives. But we're told as they do so, they are glorifying and praising God in what they do. I think if Christmas is to mean anything to us, it's that when Christmas is over, we go back to our lives. We go back to what we were doing before. When the pandemic's over, hopefully we go back to some sense of normalcy. But it's the way that we do that, the attitude we bring to that. And for the shepherds, their lives, their existence would never be the same again. They go back glorifying and praising God. I don't know that there's a better description of how to live one's life in response to the gift of Jesus Christ. That you live your life, whatever you do, if it's tending smelly sheep, if it's working in an office, if it's whatever you do, that you find ways in your life to glorify and praise God in your daily living. I think that's the message of Christmas. I think that's the way to live it the best, is that when God reaches to us and we experience that amazing love that God has for people in low places like us, we go into the world rejoicing, grateful for the gift, and seeking to share the glory of God with every person we meet. Yes, friends, God's got friends in low places like you and me. Thanks be to God for the gift of God's love. Let's pray together. Gracious and loving God, we thank you so much for the gift of Jesus Christ. We thank you for the story of the shepherds, the story that reminds us that you indeed care about the least and the lost and the last. God, remind us of the inherent worth and dignity of every person. Remind us that our lives matter to you. And I pray that you would bless us on this journey to find that child in Bethlehem, that we may not only find him and discover the love that he shares with the world, but that we may be a part of his mission to share that love with the world through our lives as we glorify and praise you in all things. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If there's someone here today who would unite with our church family by your profession of faith in Christ or by your transfer of membership to our church from another, we would love to have you as part of our church family. You can reach out to us today to join our church by sending us an email at join@fumcr.com. Or if you have any questions about what it means to be a follower of Christ or what this journey to the manger is all about, or if you have questions about what church membership is about, send us an email to that same address, join@fumcr.com, and we'll be in touch with you this week. Let's continue our worship through music.
Lord came down, our glory shone.
Thank you for worshiping with us again today. We're so glad to have you as a part of our worshiping community this day, and we pray that you've been blessed. We again invite you to our Christmas Eve worship services. 4 and 6 will live stream and Facebook Live and on YouTube have those services available. And then at 9 and 11, we'll be broadcasting on local television. And again, we would love to have you tell your friends to join us for our Christmas Eve worship services online. May God's peace go with you this day. Remember that God's got friends in low places like you and me. God has reached to us that we might experience the joy, the love that God has for us, the worth, the dignity of every life. That's Christmas. May we take that message into our world, into our lives, and glorify and praise God in everything we do. Let's go into the world to share God's love. Amen.